home.
Amen.
When you go on those big trips, you know, it's fun getting there and fun doing it, but isn't it good to get home?
Yeah.
And I was thinking the other day, we were gone for like 60 days. That's the longest I've ever been away from home. Uh-huh. You know, but like Delana mentioned last week, it was just nice to get back home. And but I had to do a few thank yous. Well, I was gone, and I watched it on the YouTubes and stuff, and had a lot of helpers.
Yes.
I'm not going to venture to even try to start saying them all for fear of missing a few. But you were here, and you seen them. We had a lot of fill-ins and had a lot of fun. I seen them.
Yes.
Had the kids and the teens and the families. And
yes.
So I want to give a special thank you for everyone who filled in there while I was gone. How can the sun affect you? I was in the sun for quite a while. How can the sun affect you? Anyone have any ideas how the sun affects you?
It can burn you.
It can burn, yeah. I seen some people on the beach, they were just red. I thought, oh man, they're going to be hurting that night.
Yeah.
How else the sun affects us?
Sun poisoning.
What?
You can get sun poisoning.
Oh yeah, sun poisoning, yeah.
Makes you feel good.
Then your life feels good, huh? It's just some kind of vitamin.
Vitamin D.
Yeah, vitamin poison.
D.
Okay, vitamin D. So, yeah, the sun can have some special effects. Sometimes it can make you delusional. And, I was that way before I got down there. the other thing it can do, it can give you tan lines. I mean, like to get the tan lines. And my wife was so impressed with my tan lines, she took a picture of my tan lines. And you heard the saying, hold your socks on, Well, ladies, hold your socks on, because I'm going to show you my tan lines. For the first time in the history of the Dixieville Wesleyan Church, you're going to see my tan lines. She says my feet glow in the dark, she says. So we had a good trip, but it is good to be back home again. How about by way of announcements, the Dixonville News, what's going on? Oh, Jen.
All right.
Jody, yeah.
It doesn't matter one way or the other. Say at least you're in the same household.
Yeah, he started.
I just wanted to touch base, and I put a post out late last night on Facebook about an alternative to our Easter egg hunt. While things are opening up with COVID and things like that, thank goodness, I was a little hesitant to jump right into a full-blown Easter egg hunt. I didn't want to cause any issues for school districts around. So we're going to attempt an alternative. I really didn't feel that taking 2 years of nothing was something that I wanted to do. And so God kept impressing upon my heart different things. And the church board is totally in support and willing to reach out and help out as well. So what we're going to try to do this year is to egg several houses in our communities, and when I say our communities, I don't just mean here in Dixonville, where you live as well. This is a vision that you, I hope, will catch, and it will not be left just right here in Dixonville. But I'm looking for pretty quick donations of candy or anything that will fit in an egg. We'll be filling thousands of eggs, hopefully, and putting them in bags for you to take out and egg your community with. So you'll be given a note that says you've been egged by Dixonville Wesleyan Church. Inside your bag will be like 20 eggs or something like that, an amount of eggs that you will take and hide in yards, place in yards around your community. One bag per household. And then inside the bag will also be a craft for that family, as well as a pinwheel with a salvation story message attached to it. So I'm looking for volunteers that are willing to help fill eggs. We need a lot of eggs filled. The Wednesday evening, the 24th, from 6 to 8, it'll be an opportunity for you here at the Ministry Center to tie into Wednesday Night Ministries as well to help fill eggs. And then on the 27th, that Saturday, is a time that we've put aside at 3:30 that afternoon if you want to come out and help canvass the Dixonville area that day. To spread that out. Now, if you cannot be here that day, that does not mean that you don't get to participate, because you can grab bags of eggs and take them and put them out at any point prior to Easter. We want to give them enough time ahead of Easter, because there'll be an announcement in there with our Easter services on it as well. So we don't want to just do it the night before Easter and they don't have time to plan whether or not they'd like to attend services. So if you are willing to help in any way, whether it's with candy, filling eggs, or if you want bags, just if you could let me know, how many families you plan to target and go out and have some fun with. Like I said, it doesn't have to just be a family that has kids. If you know a middle-aged couple that just maybe is, you just feel like brightening their day, let's face it, everyone likes candy. Pastor proves that every Sunday when half of the congregation wants to come up for a children's message. If you're willing at all to help out, please see me after church today or shoot me a message online or text me or something like that so that I know we can be sure to have enough materials available for as many bags as we need. Anyone have a question?
Good idea.
But the candies need to be small enough.
Yeah, small enough to fit in an egg. Yeah, we're just, everything's gonna be going into eggs. And, you know, eggs come in different shapes and sizes, I know, but as long as we can fit it in there, that'll be great. And it doesn't have to be candy. If you have stickers or you have, you know, if you want to donate pennies or dimes or something like that to put in them, anything that'll fit in an egg, we'll be happy to stuff.
You can get
in
a
there.
Bag of little toys, like
right,
rings,
little bouncy balls
and rings,
yeah.
And stuff.
Absolutely, absolutely. So yeah. We're going to have to throw it together pretty quick, but I think God's got it already under control with some things that have been happening.
Do you need eggs?
If you're willing to do eggs, because that's great. We've got a bunch of eggs. My mom started counting, and Hazel, they started getting things together and putting them in bags of 100 already. But these will be eggs this year that we won't be getting back. Like, normally when we do the Easter egg hunt, we get those eggs. Yeah. So it'll be, you know, kind of an ongoing thing at this point. So
egging your neighbor's house does not include...
real eggs. No, it does not include real eggs. But we should do it very safely. My goal in mind, the number God gave me was 250 houses. So if you are able to help with that or if we exceed that goal, that's all in God's hands. So let me know. I'll look forward to hearing from you.
More announcements. Anyone else?
Rodney, I have two for Blankets Ministry. One, the first blanket of our seniors is in the back. Over the next several weeks, we will be tying knots and saying prayers for our seniors. Don't forget to stop back and do that. And also, we got approval from the board this past week to go ahead with a Good Friday breakfast. Good Friday breakfast will be on Good Friday at 9 a.m. in the morning. Because of how things have been for the past year, there will be no charge for the Good Friday breakfast. There will be a basket there if you would like to give a donation. That way, those that have had issues with COVID and no jobs and whatnot, that doesn't limit them out from being able to attend because of finances. We will have a sign-up next week so that we have money to actually prepare for, but we will be having Good Friday breakfast.
Looking forward to that breakfast.
It was driving us crazy. So.
It's a monk thing, right? You can watch monk. My wife likes to watch monk.
Yeah, monk. Okay. I said monk.
Okay, any more announcements? Yes, you have a card to read?
Yes.
While you're getting it, I got one. Your kind expression of sympathy will always remain in our memories. Thank you for your thoughtfulness. That's my brother-in-law, Gene, who after the passing of my sister. I believe that there was a blanket given to him, and they held a memorial service here. And so he was thankful that you provided, so.
Yeah, this is from Trail Life Troop 2215. It says, Dixonville Wesleyan Church, thank you for allowing us to use your fellowship hall to bake cookies. Your kindness has allowed us to bless the healthcare workers at Indiana Regional Medical Center. Thank you again. God bless Trail Life. About 7 o'clock in the morning yesterday, I heard people coming in and I heard voices and I'm thinking, who are them? I don't recognize those voices right off. That must be Jerry and Dennis. They must have got some bulbs. They want to do bulbs or something. And then I thought, no, there's too many. And then I looked and it was Trail Life had come in to bake cookies to take down to the hospital health workers. So you guys are part of that, let the ministry center be used to do that. So thank you from them.
Any more announcements? couple months, but I assume you still donate money here to the church. And it's the typical way, you give it to Foyers, or you can send it to Sandy at her address. Online giving is still available, right, Pastor? And then, of course, for missions, send it to Jen's house here.
That's all in the bulletin.
Okay, good. Check your bulletin. We're ready for that congregational. Walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. Gives us. So I'm looking forward to the message, Pastor.
We have hope that His promises are true in His strength. There is nothing we can't do. Yes, we know there are greater things in store. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome.
Consecrate yourselves and be holy, standing if you would. Take my
Share this morning?
I do.
Yes.
I'd like to take Janie out to McDonald's on drive-thru.
Amen.
First time in a year, and I'd like to give her a hug.
Amen.
Which was
fantastic.
Just awesome.
Yes. Yeah.
But the cutest thing about taking her out, and I have to tell you this,
She got in the car, and she was rummaging in her purse, and she gets out this little piece of paper, it was folded, and she handed it to me, and Jamie does it right. So I looked, I opened it up, and it said one large fry, and there was some money in there, and it was from her roommate.
Yeah, I can imagine being shut in the rest home for the last year and not being able to get out. Any others?
I want to praise God that Mama's here today.
Amen.
And she's not feeling 100%, but she's here.
Amen. Glad she's out of the hospital.
I'm going to Alabama Tuesday and make prayers for the drive and everybody.
Okay. So pray Butch drive to Alabama and back. Get safety on the way. Anyone else?
I want to thank everybody for their prayers for my brother. He broke a few ribs and he punctured his lung, but other than that, he's on the way to mending. So praise God for that.
That's amazing, yeah. He had a tree falling, for those who didn't know. It's kind of, go ahead, Connie.
I had requested prayer for my mom's sister, Ruth, that was diagnosed this past fall with leukemia. Then she went into sepsis, and with COVID and everything, no one was able to get in to see her. Her kids were able to get in about a month ago to see her, but in the past week, they have turned her over to hospice. Mm-hmm. And I would just ask that you would remember the family. It's been a long 6 months when they weren't able to see her, and now that her time is limited, I just pray that God blesses them in that time.
Amen. Remember those.
If you'd remember my daughter Debbie and her husband had COVID.
Okay.
Jeff. And just thank you, everyone, for your prayers.
Amen.
And God's hand upon my life.
Amen. Remember Jeff and Debbie with COVID. Yes.
Two guys that I've gotten very close with over the years working with the district men's ministry, Paul Sheets and Stevan Sheets. Sally, Paul's wife, and Stevan's mom went to be with the Lord last night, so I just praise God that she's celebrating with him this Sunday morning, and just ask for prayers for their families as they cope with that.
Yeah, Paul and Stevan both pastor here in the district. Stevan's at Hyde or Clearfield. So yeah, remember that family. Any others? Yes?
Yes, I want to praise God for my granddaughter that's been with me through a lot of problems and that.
Amen.
Invited us to church today.
Amen.
I'm glad to be here. It's been a long time. It's good to be back home again.
Amen. Good to have
and I praise God for my, I got both shots and no side effects.
Fantastic.
Thank you, Lord, for that.
Yeah, that's great. That's great.
I think it would be good to remember the pastoral prayers. We vote for Pastor Trump.
Is
that a Freudian slip?
I want to know who's running against
him. Don said Ray was. Yes. Any others request? Yes.
Over the next 2 weeks, I'll be interviewing for internships. Definitely need prayers for that because it's based on whether or not I'll get to graduate. So with COVID, it shut a lot of places down.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of limitations on where we're allowed to go and what we're allowed to do.
Okay. So pray for an open door for Tyler with internships and pray that he gets the right one where God wants to use him at. Any others? Remember Karen, she's recovering from surgery still. Not forget her. Any unspoken requests you have this morning? Want to share it for the Lord? Okay, for all you come and give us a prayer.
Standing if you would as we prepare our hearts for prayer. And as always, our altars are open for those special needs and concerns in our hearts. Feel free. Thank you.
Father, we thank you that you have left the temple in Jerusalem. And the veil was torn when you were at the cross, and now we are the vessels. We are the temple. We are the place where your Spirit dwells. Lord, help us to begin to understand how glorious, unbelievable that is, that you have chosen us to be the carrier of your Spirit to the world. We praise you for what you've done, Lord. We thank you for the answers to prayer. We thank you for Janie and getting able to get out. And we thank you, Lord, for the wonder of a hug that's been absent for the past year. We thank you, Lord, for the way you've helped us through this COVID season. We ask you to help Jeff and Debbie, Lord, as they're going through it now. Bring health and healing to them. Continue to touch Cheryl, Lord. Bring healing to her body and bring up the blood count like you want it to be. Continue to help Karen as she heals as well. And we pray for Betty's brother, Lord, that you would help him as he heals. And let there be no infection. Let there be no more complications, Lord. But bring your healing to him, we pray, in body and soul and spirit. May he know that the hand of God has kept him from losing his life during this time. We thank you, Lord, for your protection. We ask you, Lord, that you would hear these requests, Lord. The one who's on hospice, who has a short time, we pray that your peace and your eternal life, most of all, will be the hope that brings them through this difficult time. Lord, for each spoken request, Lord, you know all about them, Father. You know the special needs. You know those unspoken that need your healing touch. Spirit of the living God, we pray that you would come and do what only you can do. We pray for Ashley that you would continue to touch her, Lord, and touch her lung, bring healing there. We pray for your grace, Lord, for each one who needs your touch this morning, Lord, in unspoken situation that needs your grace. Lift them up. We pray for Darwin, Lord, as he's home, that you would bless him and watch over him. We pray for those who may be seeing it online who need your special touch this morning. Lift them up and strengthen them wherever they may be as they listen to this service today. We thank you, Lord, that you're not bound by time or space, but you can be any place at any time, and we pray that you would touch those as well. We lift them all before you, Lord, that you gain all the praise and all the glory for what you're going to do as you answer these prayers. In Jesus' name, amen. Say hello to somebody next to you and before you sit down.
Hey, babe.
Whether you give an elbow bump or something.
Hi, Becky. How are you? Pop my shoulder. Reached into my bag at work to grab my Chromebook and my binder.
You were touched by Butch. Butch.
All I did was go to pull it up and it popped.
And that's your, is that dominant or non-dominant?
Yeah.
Well, you know what? 3 weeks ago I did something to my back. Well, my back always hurts. You know, as a nurse I have back injury. It will not. I'm going tomorrow to see if I get an x-ray, something. It won't go back into place.
Chiropractor.
Yeah.
Chiropractor.
Yeah, well, I do. I see one that just about once a week, and I've done this for 30 years. I see him for my neck. And
yeah.
But it's, I'm going to see if they'll do an x-ray tomorrow because it's on.
Yeah.
It's hip.
Let me ask you a question. What would you do if Jesus appeared in your dreams and told you to follow him? And you're not a Christian. You've never gone to church. But all of a sudden, he appears in your dreams. You don't do anything. The next night, he appears in your dreams and he says, I love you. I died on the cross. I paid for your sins. I want you to follow me. You don't do anything. The third night, he appears in your dreams. He can do it for 30 nights in a row. What would you do if your whole family is Muslim and you get killed if you convert to Jesus? And that's exactly what we're talking about in this program. And Tom has written some best-selling books about people that have been caught in these situations because Jesus is appearing to Muslims, thousands and thousands of Muslims in the Muslim world. That's what we're going to talk about today, that Tom and Joanne, God has picked them out to show them what is happening around the world where Jesus is appearing in the dreams of Muslim people. There's 1.5 billion Muslims in the world, and they are in restricted countries where they don't have Bibles, where they don't have TV shows, where they don't have radio. They haven't got another Christian that they know. There are no churches, okay? God loves those people, and he has come up with a way of coming to them. And Tom's going to talk about that. In fact, Tom, tell me, how did you get involved in understanding that Jesus himself was showing up in the dreams of Muslim people around the world?
Well, you know, originally I was in Jerusalem in a Bible study about 2001. So it was right after 9/11, and we're in this Bible study, and people are sharing. And one of the men in the Bible study, his name is Mohammed. And so he's sitting right next to me, and after he shared a little bit, I said, Mohammed, so it's an interesting name for a believer. And he said, yeah, I grew up strict Muslim. And I said, were you just looking for a relationship with God? Were you just wondering what it was like and just tired of Islam? And he said, no, actually not at all. I said, well, what happened? And he said, Jesus started coming to me night after night and telling me that he loved me. He was in this white robe. And I knew of Jesus. He's a prophet in Islam, but this love, this warmth, I just had to find out more, and I started seeking. And that was the very first one, and I thought, well, that's a little unusual.
Yeah.
Then I started finding out it was happening around the Muslim world. Wherever we went, we were meeting Muslims that had become believers, and it all started with a dream.
Yeah, Iran, Iraq, Syria, even in Egypt, it was happening so much in Egypt that some of the Christian ministries started placing ads in the newspapers. What were those ads? What did they say?
Yeah, right in the middle of the Cairo Times. Have you seen a man in a white robe? Call this number. Have you had a dream about Jesus? Call this number. After a day or two of the ads, they were pulled immediately. The Islamic authorities said, get rid of those. But they were just covered with calls.
Turn to Acts chapter 3. I tried to find crutches, but evidently they didn't make the moving truck. And so they're still in Kentucky somewhere. At least I didn't see those. These are the best I could find. If you see someone who is crippled, who has trouble walking, usually they have some kind of assistance, something to help them get around, whether it's a walker when we've gotten up in age, or we've had a knee replacement, or we've had something have a walker. We may have crutches to bring us about, a little chair. I seen the man this week, Bradley Walker, who does a lot of singing, country music, gospel music, who's in a motorized chair because of cystic fibrosis. We're going to encounter a man that is so badly crippled that he can't walk with crutches. He can't walk at all. In fact, he's carried to where they lay him at the temple gate, because even crutches won't help him. He's so far gone that he has to have somebody walk him and carry him to that place. In Acts chapter 2, verse 43, I just want to highlight this before we get into chapter 3. It said there that everyone was filled with awe at the many, underscore many, wonders and signs performed by the apostles. And so in chapter 3, he says, let me tell you about one of those. Let me give you an example of what one of those many signs and wonders were that the apostles did. And so he tells us about this one story here, one of the many. Again, this is not the only time it happened. It was just one. And he said, here's an example of that as Luke writes this. He says, one day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer, which was 3 in the afternoon. Now a man who was lame from birth, was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. And when he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. And Peter looked straight at him, and as did John, and Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. He's expecting money. But Peter said, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk," or get up and walk. And taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. And he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping or leaping, depending on the translation, and praising God. And when all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would help us today as we look into your word. May it not be the word that just tells of a long ago story in a land far away. But Father, may the Holy Spirit bring it to us that you wrote it down for us. It happened in their day for those who saw it, but you wrote it down for this day, this congregation, this people, that we may hear it today and with fresh eyes of faith may believe it. We pray in Jesus' name. We find here that God begins by grabbing attention of the people. He grabs our attention because we are often so cold-hearted or so busy, so obsessed with our life and doing this and that and our apathy. We don't really care about religion, don't really care about these things too much until somebody maybe invites us to church, but there's something often in our hearts that we would just rather get along without God unless we absolutely have to have him. And then we've kind of reluctantly, okay, God, I guess I'll serve you if I have to. And God has to grab our attention, and many times he does it in many ways. Here in the King James, it says that this man was sitting there begging alms. Now, alms was a Jewish term that meant giving to the poor. So he's sitting there begging, asking for alms, A-L-M-S. And so it was a benefit. As you're going in the temple, it'd be like sending somebody outside the church door and say, if you give to the poor, God will bless you. And so we're sitting right outside the front door so that everybody that comes in has to walk by him. And so they'll feel guilty or they'll want to be blessed, and so they'll give alms. And so one pastor preached on this on Sunday morning, and the next week he saw a little girl, and she said, "I liked your message on Sunday." He said, "Really? What did I preach on?" She said, "You preached about that man who asked for arms, and God gave him legs." Well, it was alms, not really arms, but she got part of the message right anyway. But God sometimes has to get our attention. And throughout Scripture, as the board's been going through Stephen Elliott's book, By Signs and Wonders, How the Spirit Grows the Church, he found a very strange way. When he began to look in the book of Acts, how is the Spirit of God getting people saved? And how's come we're getting so few saved and they seem to get a lot saved? And he found it's like 1, 2, 3. First of all, God would grab their attention with some sign, wonder, some event that would get their attention, and then somebody would explain it. They would share the gospel. They'd say, here's what this means. This sign is pointing to this. And then God would call them for a decision. God would say, what will you do about that? Will you follow me? And oftentimes, many were saved. In fact, in Acts chapter 2, we find the chapter right before this, we find that the wind comes through in a powerful way and tongues of fire rested upon their heads in a spiritual sense. And the Spirit of God filled all of them. And they went out speaking languages that they'd never heard, but the people who listened knew the language. And they were amazed. And he says, repent and turn to God, and 3,000 were saved. In this chapter, we find the same thing happening. Peter and John come and meet this guy who's lame, and they heal him. And then Peter explains, he preaches again, here's what this means. And then it says up to 5,000 were saved. In chapter 4, verse 4, we find that now it's up to 5,000. It seemed to be the kingdom pattern of God. He would get their attention, and then after he got their attention, he explained what had happened, and then once he explained it, then they would know what happened. But say, why in the world? I mean, this guy had been here every day. He'd been laying at the temple gate every day. Peter and John had passed him every day. What's different? The Holy Spirit had fallen upon them. I mean, Jesus had already told them. They knew what the instructions was in Matthew chapter 10 when he first called the disciples to them. It says he gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. And in Matthew 10 verse 7, a few verses down, he says, and as you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, drive out demons. Freely as you have received, freely give. And then there are 72, not just the 12. And Jesus says to them in Luke 10, when you enter a town that you're welcome, eat what is offered to you, heal the sick that are there, and tell them the kingdom of God has come to you. And so he told them to heal the sick. And so Peter and John are obeying, but this time the Holy Spirit gives them the power to do that, the power to know what to do. And so we find the example, this man who's been carried in and he's laying there, and the people are walking by. They've seen him year after year. They've seen him since birth. People have brought him in, maybe his family, and they lay him by the temple so that people will come down and give him money as they have to go buy him into the temple. And it says in the scriptures that this man asked for alms. As Peter and John were walking by, we don't know how many more were sitting there. There may have been more than one, but it says he asked and kept on asking for alms. Alms, alms for the poor, alms. And so he's not just sitting there quietly. He's asking for this. And so Peter and John look at him. And Peter says, look on us. And so the man's happy. He didn't want to get some money. He said, look at me. So I'm looking and expecting. My hands are out. But Peter said, I don't have any silver or gold, but in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And then Peter reached out his hand and raised the man to his feet. And it said instantly, Luke being a physician, said his ankle bones gained strength. His nerves began to work. Everything began to come together. This man who had never walked in his entire life, who could not even walk with crutches, now comes to his feet. How do you think he reacted? Thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad you did this. That's not what he said. It says that when he came to his feet, he began walking. And as he walked, I mean, if I was that excited, he said, see, walking and jumping and leaping and praising God. He was walking and leaping and jumping and praising God. He was so loud that he got all the attention of all the people. They said, isn't that same guy that laid at the temple? I mean, what he was laying on is gone. He's gone. That's the same one. That's how in the world? And so God grabbed their attention with this thing that they had never seen. Jesus had healed the sick. Jesus had caused the lame to leap as the prophets had said he would, but Jesus is dead. He died. Now he rose again, they said, but his ministry's over on earth. Well, not so much. Luke says in the beginning of Acts, he says, I wrote the first book, Luke, to tell you what Jesus began to do and teach. And Acts is what he continues to do and teach through the Holy Spirit and his church. That he still is getting people out of their unbelief, and especially like the Muslims who don't have a preacher, don't have the gospel, and if they hear, they may die for their faith if they choose him. So he has to grab their attention, and he often grabs it through a miracle or some sign or wonder. One family was traveling from Turkey to Athens. They lost their set, they was in a boat. They were migrants, and as they were traveling, they lost their seven-year-old daughter out of the boat. They were terrified. Everyone on the boat was looking. Where did the girl go? She went overboard. She's gone. Where is she? They couldn't find her. And all of a sudden, she shows up on the other side of the boat, dry, and says, this man that walked on the water brought me over to this side, and I'm okay. And her parents thought, this woman, this girl has lost her mind. She's being silly. She's making up something.
She drowned.
And so they arrived on the island of Lesbos, and they met a Christian who made a fire and offered to talk to them. Again, he didn't know what had happened. He said, would you like to know about a God that walked on water? They began to cry. The man had never used that illustration in evangelism before, but this morning, he felt like he had to. And they said, who are you? He said, I'm a Christian. They said, what do you mean by walk on water? And he opened the Bible story of Jesus walking on water, and they continued to cry. They said, our daughter fell off the boat. We thought she was crazy because she was dry on the other side. And we didn't understand it, but she kept saying, it was a man who walked on water who took me to the other side. All of a sudden, they're ready to hear about Jesus. They're ready to hear about the one who died but rose again, but he's still alive, and he's still doing things today. He's the risen Savior who walked on water. He demonstrated that. He showed us. And you've seen that here, and you've seen it in your own church. You see what Christ has done. The risen Savior, he's not still in the tomb. We talk about a risen Savior, but sometimes we act like that he's up in heaven and he's never been heard of since. But the risen Lord does all these things. I told you last week that our grandson had been having all kinds of seizures, and they gave him medicine. He's still having seizures. They changed medicine. He's still having seizures. And finally, we went down and prayed for him, laid hands on him, and he hadn't had a seizure since. And that was Thanksgiving 2017. He's been off the medicine for over a year. Why is he any better? Because the risen Lord is not just in heaven. He's here now.
Amen.
He's here with us. I mean, you have Shake and Mary who gave you donuts this morning. Shake was in a mine accident that smashed his head, for those who don't know. And he should have died, but the risen Lord said, oh no, that's not going to happen. And he's still here today. Mary had a brain aneurysm that could have taken her out. But the risen Lord, who's not just in heaven but walking on earth today, said, no, that's not going to happen. Because God gets our attention sometimes with these things so that we can hear what he has to say. He's still working today. I heard a story as we sat in working on the church. A guy was about 30 years old, decided to go ice skating. And in ice skating, he fell and kind of turned and hit his head on the ice, and he was not kind of silly, but being a normal man, he said, I can still drive to the house. It's just a short ways down here. So he gets in the car and drives down to the house, and doesn't really get checked out because, you know, he's a man, and men don't do that. But after 2 months of still having issues, he goes back to the doctor, and the doctor does a test, an exam, and he says, you've got blood between your skull and your outside of your skin. You shouldn't be here. And we're going to have to drill holes in the side of your skin to let this out. 2 months after he'd had this severe head trauma, but the risen Lord said, you're still here. Why? Because he's still walking the earth and through his spirit. He's still moving through his church. He's not the risen Lord who retired. But he's still here. But someone has to explain the gospel many times. When someone hears about Jesus, even he appears in a dream. This happened hundreds and thousands of times to Muslims who have only heard about Jesus through the Quran. ISA is the way that they spell his name. And for him to become real through a dream, then they, but what's this mean? How do I do this? One man got to dream about Jesus, and he said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And if you want to know more about me, take 3 days' journey down to this certain road. And down there, somebody will meet you that will tell you about me. So he takes a 3 days' journey, and he gets to this certain point on the road. And here comes every Home for Christ missionaries. And he said, are you the ones to tell me about this man who appeared in my dreams? And they shared with him who Jesus was and gave him a Bible. And he became a follower of Jesus. You see, the miracle got his attention, but he still had to have somebody to explain it, like Peter did here. And so when the miracle happened, the man is leaping and walking about, and Peter said, that's just a sign. Let me tell you about that sign. And he says, don't look at us like it's our righteousness or our power that raised this man who couldn't walk. He said, this Jesus, whom you crucified, and you chose Barabbas, the murderer, instead of him. He died on a cross, but he rose again. He's still alive. He's the one. In the name of Jesus, by faith in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, this man walks. And he said, I know you did it by ignorance. You didn't know you were crucifying God's son. He said, but if you'll repent and turn to God right now, you can be forgiven because Jesus died for your sins. And it said that 5,000 then became a part of that. Remember a month or two ago when Sam Abraham and his wife was here, Rekha, his wife, talked about how that her dad, she was a Hindu. She didn't know about Christianity or anything about it, and how that her dad had a massive stroke in the hospital, was going to die. There was no way out of it. And she went to her temple to pray, but nothing happened. She went to her gods, and they have all kinds of gods, and she prayed and nothing happened. And she finally called out and said, if there's a real God anywhere, a true God, who can hear me and save my dad, I'll be your slave the rest of my life. Remember what she said? The words came to her that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That's familiar to us. It wasn't to her. Where did that come from? What does that mean? Again, it was a miracle, but what does it mean? She went to her priest in the Hindu temple, and they said, I have no idea what that means. She went to other places, and what does that mean? They didn't know. She went to the Muslims. What does this mean? They said, I don't know what it means. Someone finally said, why don't you try the Christians? Maybe they know something about it. So she went to one of the Christians and said, do you know what this God so loved the world that he gave his only son means? They turned to John 3:16 and said, here's what God said. He's already spoken to you, but it says, and whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And she became a believer. But it had to be somebody who shared the gospel with her so she would know what had happened. But God calls us to respond. Peter says to them in verse 19, repent then and turn to God so that your sins can be wiped out. Do you realize this morning your sins can be wiped out? Wiped out, gone. And times of refreshing may come from the Lord. It said many who heard the message in 4:4, and the number grew to 5,000. But some didn't believe. Some turned away. Some says, we don't believe in no resurrection, no raising from the dead. That doesn't happen. The Sadducees didn't believe there was a resurrection. And for them to preach that Jesus not only died on a cross for our sins, but he rose from the dead and he's still alive, was utterly impossible. So they rejected it. And it says they seized Peter and John and put them in jail because it was evening. What do you need the risen Lord to do for you? He's still alive today. Whatever our need is, he's here to perform it. He only asks you, will you? If you're not a believer in him, if you've not put your faith and trust in him, he says, will you follow me? Will you repent of your sins and turn to me and let me wipe them out? Or he says, if you're a follower of mine, but you've never really made me Lord, I'm your Savior, but you've never let me be in full control. Can I be Lord? Will you let me be Lord? Or what's the need of your life right now? He's not the God who retired or is on vacation. He's the risen Lord who's here today. As we've seen around the world, thousands and thousands of Muslims with no preacher and no church and no way to get to them. Jesus, the living Jesus, is still appearing and calling them to him. And he's calling you this morning to him too, because you get to hear about Jesus who died on a cross. Not for his sins, because he was perfect. He died for your sins. Not to bring them up, not to taunt you with them, but that he could wipe them out. Wipe them out. Will you let him? Let's all stand this morning.